You are listening to the audio production of The Way of Abundance, a 60-day journey into a deeply meaningful life, written by Ann Voskamp, published by Zondervan, and read by the author.
The Way of Abundance, a 60-day journey into a deeply meaningful life. To my beautiful mama, Linda, whose name actually means beautiful, because God knew right from the beginning who you would be. Introduction. Men of the breaking hearts had a quality about them not known to or understood by common men. They habitually spoke with spiritual authority. They had been in the presence of God, and they reported what they saw there. A.W. Tozer, The Pursuit of God. There are a million stars, a trillion, flung across the summer sky, a million more than any of us can count. The night sky can seem close over the farm. There are nights over our fields that it feels like we could grab the Big Dipper itself and ladle up light. There are nights that can feel bathed in abundant light. When the Perseid meteor shower falls in mid-August, we spread blankets out by the edge of the stilled and drowsing wheat fields and watch for streaming fireballs of light to fall into our waiting hope. Some nights we just sit at the edge of the farm porch, sit at the edge of all the things that have gone wrong in a day, and watch the courage of stars blazing brave in the dark. Sitting together under a blanket of stars, one of the kids muttered it. What are stars made of? Where does all that light come from? I tried to remember what I'd read in one of my old science textbooks, tried to explain it slowly so they'd listen, remember what stars really are. Stars are made from explosions and collisions of elements. Stars are made from a breaking at their center, which allows for a process called nuclear fusion, a process that releases an enormous amount of energy, of light. I murmur it again because how have I never seen the stars quite like that? Stars are made from a continuous breaking. And it's the gravitational friction of this breaking that makes them bright. Breaking, then blazing. This is always the abundant way of the universe. Brokenness multiplies into abundance. This seems impossible, unlikely, and this is the unfailing way of God. Multiplication happens out of brokenness, and the sum is abundant life. Stars are the scars of the sky made into the light of the world. What would happen if the scars you carry are what God uses to carry Christ to a scarred and broken world? Weak is the real strong. Brokenness is the real abundance. Breaking, then blazing. Dying, then rising. Trust the abundant ways of the universe, the ways of Almighty God. Scars are but stars that let his light burn through the night. Stars and scars are signs that point the way. I never told the kids that the brightest stars are known as supernovas, that when a star dies, it sends out a massive shock wave, that the death of the star is known as a supernova explosion, appearing in the night sky many times brighter than the surrounding stars. Die to pride, die to self, die to agendas, die to comfort, die to ease, and your life explodes with abundant life. Unexpectedly, the secret to abundance is not about self, but about dying to self. For the holy sake of our blessed sanity, we've got to go lose ourselves so we can find ourselves, breaking then blazing. That's what this book is about. These are pages about the wildly abundant life found in wildly unexpected places. These pages are about taking the dare to journey into a deeply meaningful life. The abundant life isn't found in what's touted as the good life bought on credit. It's found in the upside-down life, in broken places with broken people, being most near the broken heart of Christ. Abundance is found in the loaves being broken and given, in the seed being broken open to new life, in the stars breaking, then blazing, and all the bits of our broken hearts. Abundance isn't about having as much as you want. Abundance is about having as much of God as you want. The starry night sky can feel like heaven has drawn near over our farm fields, over our upturned seeking faces. Out of the greatest brokenness, you can most greatly experience God's nearness. It's okay. It's really okay. There are nights I step out on the porch, look up, and just exhale. Do not ever be afraid of broken things. This is the beginning of abundant things. The stars bear witness. Maybe all fear of loss, of not enough, of scarcity, of lack of abundance, is but the notion that God's love ends. But when does his love ever end? The stars go on forever, infinitely, over the farm. When you step into our house from the farm's front porch, you can see it hanging over our old barn beam table, a canvas of lit and colored squares that suggest Christ hanging on the cross. They call him that, the bright morning star. His hands reach out in surrendered givenness. Christ takes the form of meaningfulness, cruciform. There's a journey toward deep meaningfulness that beckons, a way of seeing, a way of stars, of the bright morning star that changes everything. And the soul can't help but ask, where did all this light come from? Part one, how can the brokenhearted keep going? Devotion one, decisive givenness. Walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Ephesians 5:2. When I saw the billboard plastered on a wall somewhere in the city, it brought me up short. I stepped back to take it in, stood there in front of it like a fool farm hick. Blazoned across three panels like a wake-up call. Why do you get out of bed in the morning? And three images. Some daredevil plunges off his surfboard. Fear of failure. An astronaut latches himself in for launch. The need to succeed. Some guy holds a curling cat. The love of your life. So why in the world do you get out of bed in the morning? I'm pretty sure I don't bother getting out of bed for any purring feline. And no, I don't have any rocket ship or this hankering to go launching off into the cosmos. And quite frankly, I've never had the guts to take on any looming wave while trying to balance on a death-defying sliver of wobbling fiberglass. But standing there before the billboard and its haunting question, and it comes as a beat under my feet, a rhythm down the street, the question begging an answer. I want to accost the steady stream of blank-faced commuters rushing past me and ask them if they know. I want to ask old men on park benches and kids on park swings and mamas at sinks with young ones slung up on tired hips and the brave who get out of bed all alone and face their own uphill road. Why? Why you with your broken heart? Why do you bother to keep getting out of bed? Do you find your feet because you're driven by a relentless fear of failure or beaten down by the need to succeed? Or do you hit the floor for the love of a ball of fur? Because this is what I know. Nothing is more necessary than finding God and falling in love and deeper into him. Love decides. Love decides everything. What you are in love with decides what you live for. What you are in love with decides what you get out of bed for. Fall in love with his hands that shaped your heart, that cup your face, that trace your scars, that caress you with grace. Fall in love with his face in a thousand faces, in the baby who meets you at the crib rail, and the teenager who doesn't want to budge, and that man who never fails to put feet to the floor and find his Levi jeans and head out the back door to brave the hard-working world for love. Fall in love with the one who fills your lungs with this breath, and all these people, and the sky and all this light, all this glorious light. You have to fall in love because this will get you up and keep you going every day. Because love decides. And love isn't about agreeing with someone. It's about sacrificing for someone. Love is givenness. Love is surrender. Love is living broken and given like bread. Love decides everything, which is another way of saying sacrifice is the essence of everything. Fall in love, fall into sacrifice, and you will always rise. Go fall in love with grace and mercy and the only one who has ever loved you to death and back to the realist, abundant life. Because the world is begging us all to get out of bed and live given. Get out of bed and sacrifice for someone hurting, for someone different, for someone forgotten or marginalized, to hold the hand of someone who doesn't look like us, to lean in and listen to someone angry and grieving and doubting the likes of us, to give a bit of ourselves to those who feel like they aren't given much real space at the table. Read the headlines, read your newsfeed, and then defy the dark and go fall in love with kids raised in different neighborhoods than yours. Fall in love with God in the faces that tell stories different than yours. Fall in love with people who think and live and walk in circles far different than yours. Sacrifice for someone so your sanity, your fulfillment, your abundant joy isn't sacrificed. Sacrifice will always leave you the most satisfied. Fall in love, stay sacrificing, and you live the most satisfied. What you are in love with in your life decides everything about your life. Love decides everything. The sun couldn't rise, and we could all rise, falling around each other, falling all around, healing, rising. For reflection, how is God now asking you to see your brokenness today? What would abundance look like in your life today? Devotion 2. In brokenness, abundant light. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. 1 Peter 2:24. Sometimes you can feel the crush of it on your brutal ribcage. Great grief isn't made to fit inside your body. It's why your heart breaks. If you haven't felt this yet, it is likely, by his severe and surgical mercy, that someday you will. There's absolutely no tidy pattern as to who gets pain and who gets peace. How had I not seen that the brokenness of this world is so all-encompassing that it encompasses all of us? The wheat stands behind the orchard, turning itself into pure gold. This is the deal we all get, guaranteed suffering. It is coming, unstoppable, like time. There are graves coming. There is dark coming. There is heartbreak coming. We are not in control, and we never were. One moment you're picking up balls of crusty, dirty socks strewn across the bedroom floor. The next moment, you're picking up the pieces of your shattered life. How do you live with a broken heart? All the wheat looks like an onyx sea. The trees at the edge of the field reach up like a lyric scratched across the sky. It's like that line of Hugo's from Les Misérables. There is a spectacle grander than the sea, and that is the sky. There is a spectacle grander than the sky, and it is the interior of the soul. How does the interior of your soul live with broken things, through broken things? Jesus died crying. Jesus died of a broken heart. Those words were still warm on his cracked lips. My God, why have you forsaken me? The movement of a life of faith.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.